Good morning. Today we are basically covering the review class of compiler construction. Particularly we are focusing today abstract syntax tree. This is again and again it will come. The two things in the compiler is very common. One is symbol table, is a very interesting data structure, and another is abstract syntax tree, which is little different than parse tree. So that we'll cover today. What is that? This is a basically not abstract syntax tree, this is a parse tree, and then how to convert this parse abstract syntax tree, async tree, we'll cover today. Let's go back, whatever we have already done. This is the compiler's basically stages. This is the first stage, lexical analyzer by finite state machine, and it will give the token, and the token is comes to the symbol table. Symbol table is one of the heart of the compiler. And then the all the syntactic checking, it is done by either top down parser or other the bottom up parser. Top down also very famous right now. Even see Python 3.9 version, they make it a LL1 parser is available. So it is not the top down parser is totally outdated, but the most of the processes are the bottom up parser. Okay, this is the syntax checking, all the syntax checking any error. Or any the either here the lexical analyzer make it tokens of the variables or various functions, and then it is called the parse tree or abstract syntax tree. It is basically not parse tree actually. It is a much compact version of a parse tree that we'll see. Then the semantic analyzer. Semantic analyzer, whether you are converted your floating point into integer and integer into floating point, all the conversion or questions of the or type checking, it is done by the semantic analyzer. It is that is simpler, and this is the front end of the compiler, and then the various types of code generation, intermediate code generation, final code generation, target machine code generation, and the optimization on it. And there are whether there is any parallel checking, whether you make a parallelizable code, and all these things. This is also a very sophisticated part. It is a synthesis portion. Next slide. The same I have told, the symbol table. Symbol table, it is again and again told, is a very interesting data structure. It generally done by a dictionary sort of thing, so that it can be searched quickly. It may be consist of not a single table, maybe consist of multiple tables. Yeah, this is our today's focus. What is abstract syntax tree? Like here it is with the tree, it is not abstract syntax tree, and the leaf nodes are a single child. And there's a lot of extra things and information are there which is not needed for compiler in the for subsequent stages. So what they do, say they make it is this version. This is making it this version. So what they do, instead of star here, in making the all operations becomes the node and all the arguments become the leaf. So this tree is converted to this tree. This is called abstract syntax tree, and you know it can be represented a kind of a linked list version. Say you are that this node is very familiar, this kind of a pointer and this operation, the link. This is very useful for storing in a computer, and you can store it in the computer very well. So this is basically abstract syntax tree, and whenever we see the parse tree, it is always in compiler, it is the abstract syntax tree we meant. And this is much compact and it takes much less space. So space complexity is much less than this. So definitely time complexity will improve. So that is it. Next slide. Another example of this abstract syntax tree. You see here all the operational nodes minus plus is here. And here is the IDX and ID1. And it was the parse tree, and it is the so sum comes to here, but it is an abstract syntax tree. This is an example of abstract syntax. Another example, let's see. This is this famous B square minus 4AC and an abstract syntax tree. What it looked like? Say B star is a B square. It comes a B square and 4AC, 4 star A, then star A, 4AC. It comes the 4AC here and B square minus 4AC. This is the abstract syntax tree version of B square minus 4AC. Yeah, this is this diagram I always again and again showing. So because this is very interesting diagram, because this is a regular language. Inside this, There are another small portion that is called finite languages. That is, finite languages means you don't have a repetition. See, in our electric switch, on and off, there is no infinite combination of it. So these are called finite languages, and which can be detected by combinatorial circuit. You don't need any circuit where the feedback path is there. So there is a finite. But if you, interesting thing is, we can make a like famous star operation, like A star B or AB star. A star B meaning any number of occasions of A, or either zero or more occasions with B. That is interesting language, A star B, or say you can say A to the power n B or A B A to the power n. So there is, or say A to the power m, A B to the power n, but there is no relation between m and n. These are very interesting languages, and these languages are called regular languages. Why interesting? Because it is infinite. Any infinite language, so that you can express your ideas in with a very minimum alphabets minimum, say 0 or 1 or AB or more. You can have a variety of expressions, and you can this expression can be caught by a deterministic finite state machine. That is a very interesting. So most of our say mechanical gadgets, all mechanical gadgets or all are deterministic by the regular languages. Even our TCP/IP communication in our elevator, or old dated ambassador card, there is no computer. These are all deterministic finite state machine. Still, we are using lots of deterministic finite state machine in our real life, and to understand operate those finite state machine, we have a regular language. But there's a big jump whenever we go for 1950s and 60s, when we can have a function call, and we call a function repeatedly, and then you need matching number of opening braces and closing braces, and there you need a different kind of hardware. That hardware is simple, a stack. With a stack, we can catch how many opening braces are there, and then whenever closing braces is coming, you take one opening braces, and then you need only a simple stack. That stack may be infinite theoretically, and that determines a plethora of very good language. That is a context-free grammar. What is context-free grammar? Context-free grammar rules, again, this language is infinite, write regular languages. But one interesting thing is, instead of A to the power m, B to the power n, no relation between m and n, here I can have some relation, A to the power m, B to the power m, m greater than m must be greater than n, or m must be less than n, or m equal to n, or m is equal to 2n. All types of comparative things we can make it by the single stack. This language is very, very useful for programs. You know the programming, you need opening brace, closing braces, they should match. So A to the power n, B to the power n, or the parenthesis grammar, these are the very, these are fundamental things in programming languages. So you need nothing but a deterministic push-down automata. That's good. But why there's so much fuss about compiler? The fuss is, this deterministic context-free language means it requires deterministic context-free grammar. But you remember, any language can have many grammar. Okay. A grammar can have only one language, a language can have many grammar, and some of the grammar may be ambiguous. But ambiguous grammar is not possible, it is not appreciated in computer science. You write a programming language, it can give two results. So we need even a unambiguous language, you should select an unambiguous grammar. Remember, this selection between language and grammar is undecidable. So there is no fixed algorithm. You have to just try it and get it. So this is a interesting part. So some of the deterministic context-free language can have no grammar. So that is decided. So it is a deterministic context-free language. We have a context-free language, but there are some, it can be found that there is some language we cannot find the grammar. So we can forget about this. So though I am not saying the non-deterministic push-down automata, that is totally out of question. Non-deterministic push-down automata it means like a palindrome. So that should looks interesting, but maybe it is not possible to realize in hardware for non-determinism. So deterministic context-free grammar, it is not possible to find it out for all deterministic context-free languages. So there is always you have to forego. There may be some of them are ambiguous. You have to forego. There are few portions that there we'll look into it. Yeah. Now this context-free grammar, it is proven that if we see that bottom-up parsing, if you have any language rule and you try to form the source symbol, you try to fire all the rules and see which are is matching, then if you go something deep down again backtrack, so this way you can parse any unambiguous grammar. But the problem is this backtracking and all these things, it can take O(n) cube. So this O(n) cube, it is not acceptable, so we have to find it so that there should not be any backtrack. So we can look ahead only one symbol at a time, and we have to detect that definitely that rule can be fired, so we should not have backtrack. So but that we have to modify the grammar little bit. So then any standard, any rule context-free grammar, it cannot be. We have to make such a rule so that by looking at only one symbol at a time, you can see that you have known already that in the Greyback grammar, that is simple. In simple grammar, S grammar, it is simple. But first we have to understand the left to right top-down approach, LL parser, because LL parser is still very popular. Typically, recently 3.9 Python comes out, they have given another option for LL1 parser. And LR parser is more common, it is a bottom-up parser, so that they left to right scanning, but they try to fire the rules so that they can reach the top. Next slide. Yeah, this is we are not going here because we are always basically will be here, so that we try to make this O(n) cube, this number of terminals, it should be dependent on O(n). So lots of techniques, LL1, LR1, this can be done in O(n), and regular grammar is O(n). So if you can find O(n), it's a good deterministic context-free grammar with parsing capability O(n), then we can write a lot amount of program and can solve the problem. Remember, this is a great generation of thinking. So we can solve a problem by repeated function call and if then else statement. Why we need parenthesis grammar? One thing is in C you need opening braces, closing braces. Otherwise, your function cannot be complete. You can, and another is if then else statement. You can have if then else, within that another if then else. So there is a nested, which else to match which then. So all these things can be done by deterministic context with grammar. Yeah, this I have covered, but it is very simple. You know the tree traversal. The tree traversal, there are techniques. One is in order, generally not used. In order means we'll go from like this is the tree. In order, we are not basically this like this. In order, no, like we say pre-order. Pre-order is we first visit the root first, visit the root, then left child, then I'll go to the again root first, left child. So this is the pre-order is a technique for the top-down parsing. Because next few classes will focus on the top-down parsing, because top-down still the very valid. Without understanding top-down parsing, you cannot understand bottom-up parsing. So what they do is, it's a pre-order traversal of a tree is totally same as in the top-down parsing, because we try to reach from the root here S and try to get the lowest most left hand symbol LL1, and post order, so what we do, that we visit root first, so we try to get it from the right side, to get it to the, try to fire the rules and reach to the top at the last, that is bottom up. And it is a more powerful language. What is powerful means? Powerful means it can cater more languages. Mere powerful doesn't mean it's acting far, it is faster. No, it is a language has more range. Okay, that is a powerful. Yeah. Yes, this is a left recursive. It is not possible in top down. You have to, that will see in our next classes, a left recursive process can be eliminated by this simple rule. By left recursive, we can always make this simple rule so that we can, but it becomes the right recursive. If we say, why left recursive? Here A is there, here A is there. So it is always a left recursive, and any top down parser cannot handle left recursive. So we have to convert to make it a right recursive. See, here it is a right recursive. Then it can be done by the top down parser. So this rule has to be changed in the grammar rule, but the essential grammar is the same. By this, we can make a grammar a suitable for top down parser. So left river, so that left recursive portion, left, why call left recursive? So here the symbol is there, again it starts with the same symbol. So this is, you cannot do it because it go to the infinite loop. Whenever the recursion will be there, and it will go to the, it might go infinite loop, and it will, and it will take inordinate amount of time. So we have to make it a right recursive function. Then it will not for the top down parser. Yeah, I have covered. This is the left recursive. I have converted to right recursive. Actually, show the same language it is coming. Beta alpha alpha. Even if change the rules, the language are coming at the same. I have taken the Hopcroft books, Aho's book. You'll get it there. So there is the subtle change of the rules. This can be done. Elimination of left recursion is a must for top down parser. What is, say, any context free grammar, you remember what I have told, any context free grammar, first it has to be deterministic context free grammar, then it is possible for language, then it has to be unambiguous grammar. So there should be no different parts tree there. So unambiguous grammar, then now I am saying that if any rule, if it is a left recursive, it is not fit for top down parsing. We have to make it a, what is left recursive? So that I have told that we have to make it a conversion one. See, here is a left recursive, A to A alpha. So it is a left recursive. Why left recursive? A comes here, A again K comes here. It may be other rules also. This is not fit for top down parsing, because the top down parsing is the simplest parsing and it can be done. So, but with backtracking you can do it. But backtracking, again you have to, backtracking parsing we can accommodate the left recursion. But the problem is ONQ, and backtracking take space complexity. So backtracking is not generally allowed, because any programming language generally 1000 and 2000 terminals. Backtracking is an inordinate of time. So we have to change the rule. So we have to make the this rule, that is right recursive. Okay, so this is same again. I'm a little bit interesting here. This is, we are here. Basically, we are here. Even you remember here, not all the spaces is not fit for context free grammar. So some of the I again and again tell you, some of the space there is a language, but we cannot find grammar. Okay, and this is a there is no algorithm for it. And another thing is, interesting thing is, if you can find two grammars, they both are unambiguous, but whether they are same rules or not, it is also unambiguous problem. It is also not, it is an unsolvable problem. So you have to do it by hand only. What I am saying that whether two grammars are same, rules looks like different. It is not algorithmically possible solvable problem. Okay, you have to check it and say okay, and you cannot never say confident that both the grammars are same. So a language can have many grammar, and at least one grammar should be unambiguous. Then it is suitable for programming languages. Another thing, what you have learned, there are some languages which you cannot find any grammar. And we are mostly interesting that this parenthesis grammar and a to the power n b to the power n. This is grammar we are interesting, because we can solve it deterministic PDA. But you say, why not? We know this thing. We know context sensitive grammar. We have a Turing machine. We have a much powerful Turing machine like our laptop. Why we are not using? Because remember, these whenever the terminals are coming, and a program may consist of 1,000 terminals. To see the rules, you go from the reverse side, and if you introduce your Turing machine here also, so this is a bounded Turing machine, if you put Turing machine here also, it can solve the problem, but it's a exponential amount of time. It cannot be solved by polynomial time, but here we have n, that is polynomial, and here maximum n cube, that is also polynomial, and here it will go to the exponential time, 2 to the power n, and unbounded. So you give a program and you have to wait whether it will solve or not. So that is a problem. So that is the reason this kind of grammar we don't use programming language. Maybe hardware will be improved one day so that we can do it, but till now it is not done. And here same is non-deterministic context-free language also, like palindrome, we do not use in programming languages because this thing is determination is actual acknowledgement is whether this string is going as per the grammar or not. It will take random try and it will take inordinate of time. It is not possible by hardware. With this, the introduction of abstract syntax tree, I am concluding here and give any question so that we can discuss in next class. This is all. Okay. Thank you very much for being the class. Thank you.